professor in political science, University of Hyderabad. His work experience is a direct, before he was a director, academic staff college, University of Hyderabad. He had served in many capacities as a registrar also, and also he served in Ambedkar University. His area of specialization is governance, public policy, education policy, higher education, training and extension. He had published 3 books and had many articles in reputed journals. He visited many countries. He was a visiting fellow of Sweden and Stanford University. So today he is here. He is going to speak on education policy making in India, issues and challenges. I think it's a very, very important topic you are going to listen from, sir. And I'm sure you will definitely enjoy his lecture. He is a very good speaker. So with these words, I invite sir to enlighten us with your values.
I apologize for coming late, because making teachers wait for 40 minutes is a sin. And then, sometimes, it happens. But let me, first of all, thank Professor Bill Grammy for giving me this opportunity of interacting with teachers. Is this orientation? Okay. Teachers belonging to different disciplines from different parts of the country. So she has rightly chosen a theme, education policy, a kind of a re-examined. Let us begin this presentation with 2 or 3 observations there. One is by late J.P. Nayak, formerly secretary to the first education commission headed by Pathare. He said that, say, all education policies are more or less status quo oriented. They are evolutionary and reformist in the perspective, but not revolutionary. This does not need much explanation, I believe. Education policies in general are evolutionary. They need to be seen from the evolutionary perspective. They emerge gradually, but can't be viewed in a revolutionary perspective in democratic societies. This is one, but there is a contrast to this, that once regarded as culture-preserving, culture-transmitting institution, education is seen as a key that unlocks door to modernization, isn't it? So these are 2 statements for you to be noted by you and to smash me in the beginning after 20 minutes. This lecture is recorded for 20 minutes because best of the best minds in the world cannot concentrate on a video more than 8 minutes. So I don't know the Professor Bill Grammy's idea, but this is a good attempt at recording some of these lectures there. Now I'm going back to the theme, that is, say, education is significant contributor to the economic, social, political, cultural development, and especially for maintaining the several institutions in the country, isn't it? Now, how you can really look at education? What are the parameters for looking at or assessment of an education policy? Do you think that you have any idea, isn't it? No. How do you look at an education policy? Some people say that, say, a literacy rate of a country more or less reflects the vibrancy of an education policy. Suppose decadal growth in literacy is attributed to expansion in educational opportunities. Large number of people enroll in education, isn't it? Therefore, that is an indicator there. There is also one more indicator, the enrollment in institutions of higher education, isn't it? Gradual increase in the enrollment there. We started with 2 lakhs in 1950s. It is now 2 crores, nearly 3 crores now, which means that, say, educational opportunities are increasing there. So one indicator of the status of education in a country is, that is, say, how many are studying in higher education institutions. So can we say, if it is 17 to 23 age group in higher education there, how do you, you know, assess a policy there? You will say that is a 30% enrollment in higher education institutions reflects average kind of, you know, average enrollment in higher education there. If it is 40, then it is considered to be, you know, going. But the world norm is about 30%. All those in the age group of 17 to 23, if they are in higher education, then it is considered as reasonably successful policy in education there. What is this called? What is this called? I mean, enrollment is called what? Access to higher education. So access is a perimeter to know the strength of an education policy there. You may be wondering, why should you know? Because you all come from different backgrounds there. Why should you know about education there? It is necessary. As teachers engaged in teaching various subjects there, the status of segments of education is most important. What is happening in elementary education, primary education? What is happening in plus two education? Who are our students in higher education there? And then what is their background there? If this is the criteria, then you need to understand, there is, you must have noticed in your classrooms, that is, say, gradually new social classes are coming into your classroom, isn't it? With no possibly exposure to education earlier. The first generation literates are now coming into education there. So problems relating to education or educational attainment of first generation learners must be receiving your proper attention, isn't it? So it should receive your attention there. So what are the learning problems there? What are the hurdles for their learning? If they are not able to cope with this, so you are all senior teachers teaching different subjects there. You will understand that of late, there is no correlation between marks or grade a student gets and his actual knowledge base. You must be seeing the dichotomy between these two. A student with 75% does not mean that he is really or extremely good insofar as knowledge domain is concerned there. He may, in all probability, be mugging up a few paragraphs here and there, vomiting out in the annual examination, and then be done with that. That is performance related there. Education policy has multiple objectives. One is access, two is equity, three is quality, isn't it? Some of these policies, latest policies, are talking about access, equity, and quality are regarded as the three pillars of the modern policy on education there. So what is that? Even earlier too, very eminent social thinkers like Ambedkar thought that educate and agitate. Unless you get educated, you can't really empower yourself there. So education has important function of empowering the people, empowering in the sense that making you aware of your rights there, or your role in society, or your responsibility as a citizen. In addition to that, your role as member of civil society and what questions need to ask the public and political public institutions and political system. What are the issues that are demanding your attention as a citizen of this country? More so, you will be noticing that newspapers are now encouraging various, citizen journalists there. Now, they are now asking for directly contributions from the citizens there. So access, we are coming discussing these things. Access, if it is access there, then we moved away from very low enrollment in higher education or access to higher education to reasonably appreciable levels of enrollment in higher educations there. How do you measure this? No? You need to measure this only through enrollments, nothing else there. So I must also give you, then how do you measure, actually how do you come to this conclusion there? Oh, let me tell you, approximately, in a situation like this, you know, 21 crore children or 21 crore plus children join about 20 lakh schools according to one estimation in the country. If 21 crore join 20 lakh schools in our country, how many are coming to higher education? Just less than 3 crores there. So many people say that ours is highly inequitous system. Actually, higher education is not going to the most sections, needy sections of the people. Why? You need to ask why. Are there no institutions? What are the reasons for people not enrolling in education? Or why are they not pursuing education? There are two sets of explanations for this. That very early in the age, you know, they drop out of the school and drop out of plus two. And when this is common, there is also additional disadvantage to girls. You know, once they attain menarche, then most girls in vast areas in India drop out of the plus two or drop out of seventh class or ninth class. Large majority of girls are. So you can say that education is not accessible to large number of people for two reasons. One, economic reasons. Two, cultural and social factors that inhibit many number of people seeking, you know, enrollments into large number of institutions there. What are the other things there? The other things are that, say, if you look at the gross enrollment in higher education, it appears that it is dominated by arts and commerce. Very few people join sciences and technology based courses there. You and me might be thinking that, you see, large number of people join various courses and then education is reaching the unreached. Yes, these are all statements there. Now, what are the public policy interventions here? You need to understand that, you see, in India, education is the most important public policy that is regarded by large number of political systems, non-political groups in our country, or political parties. Almost all political parties sway by education and educational development. Is this true? What is your reaction? I made a statement that is, almost all political parties are committed to education, isn't it? Do you think so? Any other point of view? Becomes?
Business.
Business, okay. Oh, that is the... Okay. Okay. Okay, first set of these three, let us try to look at it from this, you know. When we say national governments require a policy for development of any sector, what we mean by that? Public policies are intended primarily to reflect the intentions of the government there. Public policy on education is one of them. What do you mean by public policy? Public policies are those which reflect the interest of the political parties for towards solving a problem there, you know. And similarly, that also is a tool through which they express disinterest also, not to take a policy there. They both, you know, either to take a policy or not to take a policy. Higher education, plus two education, vocational education, professional education, primary education, legal education, medical education, take any sector there, apart from that, demographic related interventions, how to support women's education, how to support SC, ST, OBC, minority education, how to support poor in rural areas, and how to support many other sections of the people. Different interventions are launched under broad rubric called public policy relating to education there. In that case, were you all happy with the way public policies in education are implemented? Why? Let us go sector wise, you know, any view relating to the elementary education? No, let us go sector wise. One of the most important aspects that elementary education is expected to achieve is instruction in mother tongue. Whether you go to Germany, or you go to France, or you go to any other advanced countries, those countries achieved considerable development in their respective domains because of a primary commitment to education through mother tongue, up to a certain level there. So in our country, what happens is that is a certain unexpected developments have taken place, and this is a country where it is known that is India a state or a nation? If it is a state, yes, it has parliament, it has council of ministers, it has cabinet, it has bureaucracy, it has higher judiciary. These are the executive, legislature, judiciary, that is how we explain there. That is state, you know. Isn't it? Indian state means institutions and how they are functioning. Is India a nation? That means that one language. You know, do we have one language? No. In that case, is India a nation or a state debate frequently crops up in intellectual circles. That is just in India a state there? That the political, the power that controls the state through the state is what is generally mentioned, whereas language is linked with nation, building a nation, building India, isn't it? How do you build India there? But public policies, let me tell you, are highly contest oriented, you know, highly contested there. For instance, in 1968 or between 66 and 68, attempts by the national government to declare Hindi as the national language was resisted so fiercely, opposed by many people, for one language there. So if you don't have one language there, how do we develop is the question from many quarters there. But we say that, why should we have Hindi on South India? We oppose. And Tamil Nadu, is there anybody from Tamil Nadu here? No. No. They all said Hindi Mudiyadi, isn't it? No more imposition of Hindi, isn't it, on us. We don't want to study Hindi there. So they will say that, apparently for us, education policy is allocating money, appointing education minister, education secretaries, appoint teachers, enroll students, there ends the matter. No, it is not easy, my dear friends, in a country of multiple identities like India. What happens is education cannot cut across many strong views relating to language, relating to nature of textbooks, relating to the quantum of knowledge which you wish to impart to the children. It is all debatable issues there. But let us not worry. In any democracy, this is how the contestation is. If there is no contestation, it becomes authoritarian regime. We are not authoritarian, no? So democracy means that to say, like, you know, we keep joking, you know, as students of political science, that to say, for a party like Congress, there are no enemies outside. All are within Congress only. Congress doesn't need opposition, because every second fellow keeps on objecting. Similarly is the case with every public policy. There are no foreigners who are criticizing our policy. All are Indians only. We don't like our own policies. So whatever the policy, whichever policy you wish to, you know, introduce there, there is always a debate. Debate is crucial for success of democracy, but debates have also have to be seen in the context of what is happening in our country and what are the demands on our country there. In this case, we are now proceeding access part less than the international norm, 23% only in higher education. As far as elementary education is concerned, two issues are flagged. One is medium of instruction. For want of time, I am limiting to it. And then what subjects should be studied, whether it is maths or it is science or it is general, social sciences, which subjects do you want children to know? There are also other subjects like that relates to looking at children in an age group where they should learn in such a way joyfully. So I am only bringing second issue here. There is no joy as far as childhood is concerned there, because you are giving them 200 books and the load of the bag is so high. All of you know that it is too heavy and it doesn't happen there. So I mean, apart from the concerns there, there are several other concerns also there. What should be taught there? I flagged only two issues. There are many other issues there. In a country like ours, where literacy has never penetrated into areas or tribal areas there, what kind of education can you offer to areas that are out of the so-called civilization groups here? Tribals, for instance, interior areas, what kind of education can you give them? Is there any unanimity about this? Absolutely no. So what should be done? For instance, in Adilabad, Gond tribes, they have their own script there. But we are superimposing regional language on them, with the result that they are not able to make out, whether they should learn the dominant language, or they should continue to learn or master the practice of learning the alphabet in Gond. So they're from this to issues relating to minority education. You have range of contested items relating to public policy there, and there are solutions are coming, but only after the problem. Escalates a level there, then the solution is coming inside there, That is how. Then when we are coming to the equality, my friend just suggested relating to education, that not every education or stream of education is accessible to the people. After 1991, when education started getting into the private provider's lab there, what happened is education became expensive. And the more education becomes expensive, the less number of people only can join that. Not everybody can afford to pursue that kind of a quality education. So therefore, large number are denied education there. So if large number of people, it's a question what many people say, question of opportunities there. If the opportunities are not expanding, then to that extent, it is not democratic form there. As the options increase, which means that to say, you wish to become a lecturer in a college or a university, that is by your choice. So far we are thinking that is by choice. If it is choice is not dictating your decision there, then it becomes what? It is not choice determined. Where there is no choice, there you are not able to put your heart and soul into education. That is why you will be seeing large number of engineers who are now thinking that engineering is not their cup of tea. Therefore, they would like to quit engineering, get into other areas there. This is called career switching. Now, midway, you will find that you don't like technology-based education. Therefore, you will switch over to other streams of occupations or employment opportunities there. So what is this? To guide a nation's progress, we need public policies. We have a policy on elimination of poverty. We have a policy for promotion of industries. We have policy for promotion of agriculture or farmers. We have policy relating to development of women or other groups, whatever they. So also, we also have policies on education there. The next 5 minutes, if there are no questions from you up to this now, we will be talking about important themes relating to education policy as reflected in 40s, as reflected in 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, now 2015, new education policy is coming there. Why is a historical examination of evolution of public policies in education is necessary? This is to know, one, that whether governments or political systems are sailing with the contemporary challenges or not, or how education must respond to the changes in economy, society, polity, how it is reflecting, how it is responding to them. So in 1940s, Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan Commission went into the need for expansion and consolidation of higher education in India. How important was science research to the country's national development there? So they said that is a, it must be supported, university level education must be supported for playing a very useful role in nation's progress there. To be on par with world science, you know, science for science sake only, but science for modernization there. But it is also realized by 1950s, Sir Mudaliar Commission. Mudaliar Commission said that say there is an important value framework, policy framework needed for vocational education. The report of Mudaliar Commission led to the establishment of series of Indian, technology, ITIs, you know, various ITI, Institutes for Technology, isn't it? Across the country, the ITI is trade-based education, like in welding, carpentry, and various other trades there. Not everybody need to get into general education was the belief there. Remember, my dear friends, that to say, as the political systems crisis also reflected on education there. We failed as far as meeting the aspirations of large number of masses in India. As far as our war with China was concerned, it is an unsettled item whether China attacked India or India attacked China, isn't it? The Indian international relations experts still keep arguing that it is Chinese aggression over India there. So that crisis has an effect on various sectors there, and members of parliament particularly asked Nehru as to what was the reason for India's low achievement in education. Is it for want of what? No. Then the government of India decided to appoint the first education commission headed by who? Yes. Kothari Commission has brought out a voluminous report running into hundreds of pages there, and they give about 400 plus, recommendations. And in our country, what happens is that not all recommendations of a commission can be accepted by any government. For what? One is that for states' incapacity to implement all the decisions there, So when in late 90s and early 2000, a PIL was raised in Supreme Court asking that right to education must be implemented by the government there. The government said that the Supreme Court in its verdict said that right to education is determined by the economic capacity of the government in power. So it was calculated that to implement right to education, 1,75,000 crores were needed at that time. So even this right to education up to what level? Fifth standard. So the intention of the government usually gets reflected through a policy, isn't it? I mean, they want a policy, and the policy was in their hands by 68. The first ever policy on education was formulated in 68 and placed in parliament and approved there. What were the major features there? This policy particularly stated that entire country should have a uniform structure of education, the 10 plus 2 plus 3 pattern. It also suggested that there must be a three language formula, isn't it, with whatever combinations there. And it also suggested that, see, there needs to be a greater emphasis on training of teachers there at various levels there. I have chosen only three. You can also add more. But the last paragraph of the 1968 policy suggested that this policy must be reviewed after 5 years. You know. That means that 68, it should have been reviewed in 73. But at that time, the nation was passing through a major political crisis that was agitations against corruption led by late J. Prakash Narayan there. All political agitations in India have far-reaching consequences on not only politics but on existing policies too. It was not reviewed, the 68 policy, and nor an important recommendation my friend said, like how much of money you need to implement this policy? How much of the GDP is required? Isn't it? Isn't it? But even after 60 years of, isn't it? 60 years, we are not even reaching 3 to 4% there, between 3 to 4%. Yes. And you all know that to say. As far as teachers are concerned, we look at policy only 7th pay commission, 6th pay commission, 5th pay commission, 4th pay commission. We don't look at policy at all. Beyond that, it is of least interest to us. And naturally, isn't it? We are all in a developing country. We also would like to get paid in a way that, you know, we are treated with respect in the system there. While that is the case there, the 68 policy could not be. But very soon in 77, there is a change in the, what? Change in the political system. The Janata Party came to power. And Janata Party said that, say, we don't believe in 1968 policy at all, you know. We want a review of that. Afterwards, they said that, say, of all the programs, national literacy program was most important. They introduced a national adult education program. You know. So afterwards, another party came to power by 80. And then that party said that what all was stated in 1977 was totally wrong and 68 policy must be brought back. So from that onwards, you know, in between what happened? In between, there was a major shift to the entire approach to public policy on education. How? You all know that, say, the 42nd amendment to the constitution, do you remember? Is an important milestone in the constitutional history of this country, isn't it? Apart from others, as teachers, we are all aware that, say, the 42nd constitutional amendment brought education or removed education from state list and brought it to the concurrency. Once a subject is in the concurrent list, the perspective about public policy changes, isn't it? Or the very approach to public policy changes. What happened? With the placement of education in the concurrent list, the role of the central government enormously increases, or expected to be increased there. And the government thought that in order to have a uniform policy on education and for effective implementation and monitoring, we need to have education in the concurrent list there. But that has disturbed the federal balance here. How? Once the subject is in the concurrent list, the government of India started initiating public policies that strengthened its role in policy making there, in education, in all sectors there. One example right now I will give you for your immediate thinking, and rest of it after tea break maybe. You all must be tired by now listening to me continuously, isn't it? One example is that, say, by virtue of concurrency, the government of India introduced three new schemes there: Sarva Siksha Abhiyan, Madhyamik Siksha Abhiyan, Rashtriya Uchchatar Siksha Abhiyan, isn't it? The introduction of such schemes only gives you an idea as to how center looks at public policy on education as a intervention or domination over the states there. So they, ignoring what is mentioned in 1968 policy like medium of instruction, etc., ignoring even the vital role that the state governments should play, you have introduced Sarva Siksha Abhiyan. Ignoring the privileges of teachers, you know, of teaching a language there, the government of India started introducing such types of language learning modules where it has centralized, you know, how you should pronounce Ramabrahmam. When I was in Sweden, many people called me Rami Abrahami. I never used to really, see, my name, I know, no, you know, why should I bother? So, in some areas, but through a scheme, what they thought was that, say, you teachers of Sarva Siksha Abhiyan are taught how to teach English. Well, I am a nationalist, you know, in the sense that I don't like somebody teaching me how I should teach, unless I am teaching wrong, isn't it, you know. But it is now the consultancy driven there. Okay, that is part one. Madhyamik Siksha Abhiyan is one, you know, where central government would like to give funds to states under a scheme there. And I don't need to talk much about Rashtriya Uchchatar Siksha Abhiyan there. Now, 3 points. One, the gradual encroachment into the rights of the states in India has its implications. One is that, say, universities stopped thinking. They think that, say, let UGC give some guidelines there. Two, series of regulatory bodies, 17 regulatory bodies, like All India Council for Technical Education, Bar Council of India, Council of Architecture, so these regulatory bodies, in my opinion, have deprived the state governments of their ability to evolve courses suitable to their areas there. For instance, Nivelli Lignite Corporation in Tamil Nadu, Singareni Collieries in Telangana, or Uttarakhand's hydroelectric power requires different skill sets there. Suppose you give one kind of curriculum only for all engineering colleges in the country there. The problem is that, say, how I can invent new courses, how I can make relevant courses for the development of the areas there is a matter there. I mean, these can be stated in different terms there now. One of them is that, say, that it is continuously believed that Union government can make policies in the best interest of the nation, isn't it? So the best interest of the nation get reflected through public policies that emanate from the Union government there. So, first of all, critics say that a policy must lay down broad guidelines relating to development of education, leave rest of the strategies for implementation to respective state governments there. Even the state governments are accused of centralization of power, depriving local governments their role in managing their schools there. So, this federal system, if you look at from the education point of view, is right now determined by policy making at the union level, control by the state level, deprivation at the local level, isn't it? With the result, if you are now thinking of expecting us to do miracles like the world rankings there, it is difficult to believe in this. You want world ranking universities there. Agreed? We should reach the world ranking. But by how can we reach the world ranking? Distribute money, encourage innovative research there. But how is it? One of the main observations of the first education policy was that, as mentioned by G.P. Naik and also by other authorities, is that to say, for some reasons, the preponderance of the union government strengthened only sciences, depriving social science and humanities, is also mentioned frequently there. A policy is supposed to encourage all streams of knowledge, you know. Okay? Instead, it has concentrated more on science, and even in general universities, people observe that to say science funding to science is more, and funding to other streams is relatively less, you know. But we believe that to say all streams of knowledge must be equal here. It is not forthcoming even in the 9th policy of education there. Let me quickly tell you that to say, after the 85 attempt, you know, by K.C. Pant on challenges to education, a policy perspective, which reviewed the education scenario, and this document also noted that there are vast changes in the economy and in the polity, in society, and people are looking for modern ideas there. By then, IT-based education already started pouring in, and ideas are coming how to strengthen IT. So once the 86 policy on education came out, approved by parliament there, it was thought that, say, the new policy on education will give priority there. But unfortunately, in our country, I told you, developments otherwise also have an impact on education. The Beaufort's what? What is that called?
Scandal.
Okay.
Scandal.
Okay. Between scandal and scam, what is superior? Okay, whatever. It has impacted so much the political system that the parties which supported V.P. Singh demanded that 86 policy must be scrapped. This is only third policy, fourth policy after independence to be. So they said that, what was their criticism? That the 86 policy promised Navodaya Vidyalayas across the country, and Navodaya Vidyalayas, ideologically speaking, it was alleged that they encourage only elitist elements. You are selecting 50 to 60 students from rural areas, putting them in a special school and coaching them in such a way that they are taken away from their main areas there. Instead, they said Kothari Commission's neighborhood schools must be encouraged. What is your stand on that? I don't know. But neighborhood schools concept, as advanced, as promoted by Kothari, were relating to a particular issue. Whereas Navodaya Vidyalayas are a kind of a concept kind of schools for excellence. So there is no comparison between these two. Even then, we opposed, and Kerala and West Bengal, Tamil Nadu for a long time opposed. Opposed even starting of a single Navodaya. What is the problem now? Is it okay? Okay. You accepted Navodaya Vidyalayas there. So that's what I'm telling you, that a critical understanding of policy is necessary to know there. Again, I'm telling you, when you are talking of public policy relating to education, you need to remember people. Who are the people whom you have in mind? Finances and institutions there. How much of money you are prepared to spend is not mentioned generally in any policy announcement. With the result, Tapan Mujindar Committee went into one aspect like compulsory elementary education, worked out that, you know, so much of 1 lakh crores plus is needed to implement one policy, isn't it? That is relating to education for all there. If there is one subject on which there is lot of, you know, political outburst, it is education. And this is the subject on which we have strong arguments, pro and anti there. Why? Why it should be like that is, according to me, is the following should make you to understand what is this. After the 86 policy, 89, Acharya Ramamurthy committee was appointed to look into the 86 policy implementation there. The 86 policy, by the time the policy reached the districts, it was 88. And 89 there was a review, isn't it? If it is a review, then you can understand that there is a stalling of the course process there, I mean implementation process, and it has raised huge issues there.